So for older works where you don't have recordings, another thing you can look at is the composer's diaries or diaries of the composer's friends. So if you're playing Beethoven, then not only look at any of Beethoven's letters or anything that he's written about the work and what he's feeling at the time he was writing it and so on, but you can look at some of his friends. Czerny is the main one for Beethoven. He was good friends with Beethoven and wrote extensive diary things, as they used to do back then. It was very fashionable. You didn't have any TV to do, kind of watch in the evenings, so it's like, okay, write in my diary, which is, you know, for us now become incredibly useful because this is kind of the running commentary that runs through a composer's life that you can kind of put alongside the compositions themselves. Another great case is the Schumanns. Both Robert and Clara would write extensive diaries every single night, and they would write about not only their own works and what they're doing in their careers and their lives, but also about each other, because, I mean, they were married, they were surrounded by each other for, well, a long time. Clara lived a lot longer than Robert, so she kind of continued. She was very good friends with Brahms as well. If you want any kind of writing about Brahms, look at his writings, but also the letters between Clara Schumann and Brahms, and then Clara Schumann's diaries on him. They were very, very good friends. Yeah, so if you can't hear them, read what they were thinking and what was happening instead. Now, another admittedly kind of picky and nerdy thing to do with recording is to check that the recording you are listening to is as authentic as it can be. So, kind of similar to the editions where you'd have many editors kind of changing works, what you now get with audio files and different kind of audio video recordings is remastering. And whilst a lot of the time this is very good and a lot of the details of the performance are actually enhanced and they're made better, this isn't always the case. Some things are lost when things are remastered. So what's interesting is to listen to as an original recording as possible, which means getting kind of nerdy. So a fantastic example of this is Rachmaninoff playing Chopin. So obviously Chopin wasn't alive during the time of recording technology. We have no recordings of Chopin playing his own work. However, Rachmaninoff was known so well for his recordings and his performances of Chopin. So these are a fantastic interpretation to listen to. Let's listen to him play a little bit of Chopin's E minor waltz. Pretty cool, pretty nice, played very, very well, nice to listen to, great. However, this recording has been remastered. This is not the original audio file that Rachmaninoff actually played. So there's only really one way to figure out what was gained and what was lost through the digital remastering, and that is to listen to the original. So this is one of my prized possessions. We actually got a record player in order to really, to listen to the recordings that you can't nowadays. There are plenty of performers in the early 20th century whose recordings haven't been digitized yet. They only exist in records. The main one that my resident concert pianist was listening to is Berno Mazeyevich. He was a Russian performer and he played a lot of Rachmaninoff and Chopin, but not only that, he would play pretty much anything, and this is incredible, but you can't listen to him online. He only exists in record form. So the good thing about classical musicians is that we're really kind of nerdy, and not an awful lot of people listen to classical music, at least not compared to kind of pop and rock and so on nowadays. And because classical music has been around longer, there are far more records in classical than there are in the kind of popular things, and they go very, very cheap. You can get second-hand ones in kind of Oxfam and little charity shops for literally less than a pound. You can have an original recording of something really, really good by an incredible conductor and stuff, and if you play it on a record player, the sound you get is a lot better and kind of more special than you get normally. So again, record player, something to ask Santa for, kind of up to you. So I found this actually on a whim, just in a charity shop looking for discs, because that's kind of what I do. So this is actually mostly Chopin's sonata in B-flat minor, so it's the funeral march sonata. That takes up 2, 4, 6, 7 sides of disc, but of course then you've got one side left. So to fill that one side, they put on the waltz in E minor. They recorded that as kind of a little encore of the work. So the sonata takes up that many discs because you could only fit so much on the kind of space, because it's a really old disc. This is from the early 1930s. It spins really, really quickly and it kind of gets over, so that's why it's just a tiny little waltz that can fit on one side. So what I'm going to encourage you to listen to is the very ending of the piece. I'll play the whole thing, but notice what happened to the ending that didn't happen in the digital remastered version. So that really, really beautiful dying away at the very end, completely gone in the digital remastered version. So that's why it's really good to listen to as authentic a recording as possible if you're going to be that nerdy about it. And I'm not saying you have to be, but always a fun thing to consider if the resources are out there.